The Magic Show is brought to you by StarCityGames.com, and check this out. On the weekend of December 12th and 13th, the StarCityGames.com Open Series comes to St. Louis for the first time ever, and this event is going to be huge. This magical weekend will feature a $5,000 standard open on Saturday, followed by a $5,000 legacy open on Sunday. Both events will offer players their first chance to qualify for the recently announced StarCityGames.com Invitational. Make plans to join us in St. Louis and be a part of the excitement.
Hi, this is Hall of Famer Frank Karsten. Welcome to the Magic Show.
Outside of tournaments.
We always catered to kind of the casual crowd. I think EDH kind of gave a face to that crowd for us. And it's like, oh, okay. Well, if someone would enjoy this in EDH, pretty sure that's going to translate to kitchen tables everywhere. We never really had a great measuring stick for what a successful casual card would be. It's kind of your own imagination or just talking to each other about what your friends used to play or what you used to see at the store. But now that EDH, you say, okay, yeah, this card's great. People actually can get up to 8 mana and cast this. It actually does crazy fun things, etc., etc.
Things like Lorthos the Tidemaker being legendary. It didn't have to be legendary, but it's legendary, and it kind of feels like it.
We definitely think about EDH. We definitely, like Malfagor, right? I mean, there's a reason he says each opponent and not, and he's not targeted, right? And that's for, like, well, I wanted him to be like, well, you're discarding your entire hand, and you're playing EDH, it better do something pretty awesome.
They did that with Cannabis.
I'm probably the most murderous, merciless version of a mind that they can turn against the world that's ever heard of yet.
In terms of Magic, how do you feel about tricking your opponent into making bad plays?
Tricky. Oh, you mean like a Jedi Mind trick?
Ooh,
Jedi Mind tricks. I like them.
I think that's where you can get your most edge from, because everyone's like pretty good now because of Modo, and in Magic there's just luck in general. So if you could get somebody to forget to pay for their Living Tsunami or forget a Bloodseeker trigger, then the advantage gained is so good.
I love them. I think they're good. I think people shouldn't concentrate too much on them, because most people, instead of trying to figure out a way to trick their opponent, should probably figure out how to play better. Like, it doesn't do you any good to Jedi Mind Trick them if you're, like, misplaying, because you give up that edge. On the other hand, tricking people is very effective. Sometimes it's your only out to win the game.
I am a fan of Jedi Mind Tricks. I have been cautious to deploy them at times because I was afraid that I would get frowned on.
Everyone who tells you that they don't use Jedi Mind Tricks is lying to you or lying to themselves or both. Every single one. Even him. Whoever you're thinking of. Even the people who are really good who next week write in the column that they don't and that I'm wrong about this, they're lying then too. I'm telling you, I've been in the conversations with them. They always pretend that they don't use Mind Tricks, and then they tell stories where they use a Mind Trick, and then they just say, well, I just thought it was the right play to try to get him to make a mistake. What do you think people are talking about? What's the difference between a Mind Trick and playing right? At the end of the day, a lot of the time, all a Mind Trick is a glorified way of talking about the right play is, in this case, assuming your opponent's going to make a mistake that you think they're going to make, and so you create a situation where they're more likely to make the mistake because they think things are different than they really are. Often that's the right play.
I actually was watching Paul Reitzel playing. He was at 7 life. His opponent had 2 3 power creatures and a Chandra Nalar in play. He draws a second fetch land. He's just absolute stone nothing. And he sits there, and he looks at his graveyard, and he does some, looks like he pretends like he's doing some math. And then finally he's just like, go. And his opponent goes, attack you, one. He's just like, yep. You know, like, clearly what he was trying to do which makes the opponent think he had something, so like maybe there's some other way he should play. That sort of thing I think is fine. I think a lot of times when, you know, players sort of not like entirely misrepresent things, but on the verge of, you know, saying something which isn't precisely true, I think I have more of a problem with that. I think, you know, it's important to, you know, be clear about, you know, what you're doing in a game.
A lot of people put all this effort into tricking their opponents when maybe they should just concentrate on, you know, not messing up every other turn. And so, you know, Bill Stark is like, well, if your opponent's hungry and you have a delicious cheeseburger, and this is a croissant, it's not a cheeseburger, so it doesn't look that good, but then they'll be so flustered by, you know, the thought of eating for the day that they'll start making mistakes. It's like, dude, why don't you just, like, try and not be terrible?
I played in the Grand Prix in Minneapolis, and my opponent forgot to pay for Living Tsunami, and I feel like I had a big impact on it. I just tapped out. I attacked, asked myself if I played a land already, which I clearly did, so I'm like, yeah, I played a land already. Then I just tapped out my mana. I said go, and he was excited because I was tapped out, and he just drew his card and forgot to pay for Living Tsunami. This happened at the Star City 5K. My opponent had two guys down, and I have, like, one guy. So basically, he could just, like, go for the win. But if I have anything, like, he just gets, like, wrecked. But it's definitely right for him to just go for the win right there. Because if I had something, I would have used it the previous turn. A lot of people never think back to the previous turn. They, like, just think on the spot, like, I'm going to top deck it. So I have my hand like this. I put my hand down, and he's thinking. And then he goes to his attack step, and I just slowly pick up my hand, and I put the fourth card from the back to the front. And I pretend like he doesn't see it, but I make sure he sees it, and I put my hand down, and then he actually didn't attack me. And if he just attacked, he would have won, and I had just all lands in my hand. So just small stuff like that definitely gets you an extra turn, gets you an extra draw step, has your opponent bury a Living Tsunami. So anything you do to try to trick your opponent playing live, I'm a fan of.
Once at a GP Seattle, I had the ability to play a Resounding Thunder, but tap seven lands to make it look like I was cycling the Resounding Thunder. My opponent was at six, and he would cast an Esper Charm during my draw step, and I was going to draw a land, so I couldn't actually, like, you know, cycle it. But I had seven lands in play, so I actually, like, tapped three lands and just said Resounding Thunder you, and he went to scoop. And then I realized if I had, you know, I kind of knew ahead of time that I could have just tapped all seven and hoped that he didn't count. But, like, I thought it might have been a little shady, and I don't really like to win like that.
I had a guy that had, like, Undo Cleric on the table in Paris and had Punishing Fire in graveyard. Whenever he plays an ally, I point out that Undo Cleric triggers, and he's like, oh yeah, I gain life. So, I mean, you just have to try it in order to win more games, but...
Is Brutal Elf Brand.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, you can fluctuate a lot.
Endings just... are there.
Endings.
Pretty much. Like, you can make it, but, like, you need Saito and someone else, I don't remember ways to lose, and first, and to play each other, and then both to lose to make top 8 with a draw. Like, or other possibility, if Terry Sill.
Okay, I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, basically, a draw is like less than 20%.
If
so, I want mine.
If you draw, you will make it if Saito and the other one lose. But if they're playing each other, you can't make it.
Just tell me.
It's probably a play. Only to get something, drink food.
Thank you. is like the fatties.
At Grand Prix Seattle, Pat Sullivan and I were having a conversation where, like, he was explaining to me his theory that, you know, there's a lot of people in Magic that just don't know how to act and things like that, and they could really, really benefit from just getting a good ass-kicking. So, I naturally just agreed. Because, you know, I can think off the top of my head just like 30 people. We just went back and forth, naming names, making a list. So we have a list. I mean, it's very extensive and somewhat exclusive, I guess. You know,
somewhat exclusive?
Yeah, yeah.
There's no exclusiveness to this
list.
Yeah,
sure.
It's everyone but like 7 people. That's not exclusive at all.
No.
The exclusive list is only like people you don't hate.
It's only like 50. It's only like 50. I mean, and for you haters out there, I am on it. I'm fully aware that if someone just beat my ass, you know, like, I'd probably benefit from that, and so would the rest of the world. But whatever, you know, like, you want my address, I'll ship it.
Show up like Jay and Silent Bob, you know?
Yeah, yeah, just
Are you Jerry T?
Yes, I am. Beat my ass, thank you.